My Stars and Other Highlights by Alan D. Nance. Introduction. There may come a time when you will want to reflect on your life and write something about it. Such a time has come for me. My time in this world has not been special or unusual to the human experience. Of course, I believe we should view each human and their life as precious and unique. Although, many lives are similar and would not be the most interesting reading material. So my story will not ask you to spend your time reading about the rain in Plainsville falling mainly on the mundane plain, so to speak. It will be from a different viewpoint, let's say the stars. My Stars is my attempt at merging real life with science fiction, or rather far-out adventure. As a youth, I was fascinated by stories of space and weird, wonderful things everywhere. Like many, I enjoyed reading certain so-called space adventures by the writers of the time, Wells, Verne, Bradbury, Asimov, and a few others that I happened upon. One book I had was called The Stars, My Destination. It was in the basement of our house on 14th Street in Oklahoma City, Oklahoma. One time, between my short readings of it, someone left me a note of a sort. It read two words at the top, My Stars. Then under that were written the names of my children and myself, Eli Maria Allen. I'm sure my wife Sally wrote that for me. I never finished reading that book, but I like to think that I reached my destination as a husband and father. In that sense, my stars have shone bright and steady. Now I will admit that I have spent many hours watching television treks to the stars while my kids were trying to get my full attention. These Star Treks captured my imagination. One thing about these shows appears to parallel me and my family. They change with our location. Let me explain. The long-running Next Generation was on television at about the same time that we lived in Florida, from the fall of 1987 until 1994. Then we lived in Oklahoma from 1995 until 2001. Those were the same years that Voyager trekked the airwaves. And finally, we landed in North Carolina when Enterprise began its five-year trek in 2001. In real life, this is nothing but coincidence, but in my stars, it has meaning. Elements of my real life, such as personalities and events, are woven into the stories. These are more or less progressive in the life of the main character. As he moves through time and space, he learns about reality and about himself. More importantly, he learns answers to age-old questions, such as, why are we here? Some of the stories are allegorical in nature. The main character learns to apply principles and truths that have come to be regarded as universal. They are good for intelligent people of any culture, planet, or star, as it were, and can apply in any time. So the main character is not from this earth. The time is not necessarily future because it is a different earth. But this is not just a collection of so-called moral lessons. We need not be trapped in a tragic world. We can take voyages to new worlds in a positive present and future. Chapter 1. Baseball Boom. It was a fine day. Sunny it was, with some light puffy clouds rolling across the blue sky. It was a fine day for baseball in early summer. The Ball Diamond was in a park on the outside edge of the city. It was a joy to hear the young players' chatter drifting up into a real sky. Most of them, being 12 years old, did not know what it was like to play under the air domes. That was years before, when the atmosphere had not been cleansed and stabilized. The time after the global atmospheric disaster, when air domes were needed to provide an artificial day, was now past. So these kids did not really know what that was like. They were indeed a new and blessed generation. This planet, healed and given a new lease of life, was our happy home. Those young players on the field were just as natural as the clouds, grass, and birds. Yes, real birds in the trees. So as the birds and the family and friends watched, the Blue Jays were at bat against the Rebels. The Blue Jays were set to win their second game in this youth team series at their home field. It was the bottom of the ninth inning, two outs, and the score was tied at 5. The pitcher for the Rebels was Aldenon 1, Betelquise 214, or Aldo for short. Aldo was feeling the pressure of this moment. These were the moments that dreams hung in the balance over. The pitcher, being the key player by putting the ball into play, was the center of attention. With his selected pitch and degree of control, he had a significant impact on the outcome. But also, with 10,000 variables on the ball, anything could happen each time. The batter, Leon, had a good average and was known to hit all pitches and pitchers. This time, he was hitting left-handed, which was his strongest. Aldo prepared to throw his pitch. He wound up and let it go. The batter connected, and it shot down the first baseline, but curved foul. The pitch was a little inside and not fast enough, Aldo realized. The home plate umpire threw Aldo a new ball. The boy with the bat, Leon, dug his feet in at the plate. He swung the bat to get ready, then held it out toward the right field as if to say, "That is where it is going to fly." The catcher signaled a fastball, which Aldo agreed with. Then he let it go. Crack! It was a line drive to the right of second base. The shortstop was there and got his glove on it. But it was high and did not stay in the glove. The center fielder covered and threw it to second, holding the runner at first. As the Blue Jays crowd was cheering excitedly, Aldo was thinking, "Okay, hold it together and concentrate. Just get one more out." This batter was a decent hitter, but not as confident as Leon. He was nervous. This was as high pressure for him as it was for Aldo. The first pitch was low, a ball. The next one was inside, ball 2. More clouds had been moving in overhead. It was hardly noticed because of the tense situation on the field. The next pitch was fouled back. The fourth one was another ball outside. The count was now 3-1. This inning seemed to be so long for Aldo as he was trying to keep his composure. The next one was a swing and a miss. It was now 3-2. Aldo could not throw another ball. It had to be a strike. Thunder could be heard in the distance. The whole visible sky seemed to be focused on this game and was reacting to the building climax. Aldo looked for the catcher's signal, but could only see a blurry hand. He threw his slider. The bat got under it, hitting it high. All eyes were on the ball as it soared higher. Then, crash, bang, boom! Lightning crackled overhead as if the ball caused it. It was a bright explosion of light fissures going out from a center that was nearly directly over the field. Since everyone was already looking up at that moment, it made quite a frightening impression for everyone. Rain started pouring down in the next seconds. No one was able to see where the ball went or if it even came down. The matter at hand now was getting out of this severe weather. The game was over. This was something that people in general had not gotten used to yet. That is the unpredictability of the weather. Under the air domes of the past, the air or weather was fully controlled, but after the atmosphere cleared up, the domes were no longer needed. Then laws were enacted that banned all weather control or tampering with the atmosphere. No more would we risk losing our precious balance of air around the globe that protects and preserves life. So the weather was going through its cycles again, and we were willing to submit to it. Everyone ran to their cars or buildings nearby. There was no cover at the ball field, except at the team benches. Aldo's home was a short distance, about a block or so away, so he ran. He ran through the rain with a feeling of relief more than anything. He was relieved that the game was over, even though he knew that it was not really over. Aldo also felt a good feeling of a new start. It was a feeling of success and contentment. He thought it was like when you have fixed up your old bike that had been abandoned outside for a long time, and you find that it rides just like new again. He hoped that others felt the same way too. Just as you cannot control fully where the bat will hit the ball, man cannot fully understand, let alone control, the natural forces. They deserve our respect. This event happened on 68 06.21 on the old Stardate system. I was known as Aldo back then in my childhood. This is my history. These are highlights and some important things I have learned in space and time. Chapter 2. I shot a slingshot into the air. Stardate 6608.13. The August sun was extended and oppressive this year for a youth who enjoyed looking skyward. Aldo and his friend Datar were at a nearby woods climbing their favorite trees. The view from the one they were both in at the moment was choice. They could see all the way down their street and up another street that met it at a 90-degree angle. From up there, they could see into some yard spaces that could not be viewed from anywhere else. Aldo's eyes looked toward the horizon and then higher, away from the sun. Not many people then liked to look up, especially in the daytime. The sky was white, not blue, but toward evening it was more tolerable to the eyes. Aldo could hear the high hum of an INT-AT craft. They flew low over the populated areas. He finally saw it coming out from behind some clouds. Then the hum got lower and lower until he realized it was entering the airspace of their community. Now Aldo and Datar could see it. It was an XAT craft. No, it was not of local origin, but from outside the atmosphere. As it came below 300 meters, the logo could be clearly identified. The SSF symbol was something that Datar knew about, but not Aldo. "What is the Secured Space Force doing here?" asked Datar. He explained to Aldo that they have taken over several planetary systems. He said they have deliberately started wars in order to take over planets and get the resources. Datar believed they were on a mission of conquest. "Don't they protect us from our enemies?" Aldo asked. "That is what they want everyone to believe, but I don't trust them for a millisecond." Then Datar speculated that they must be trying a new way to get recruits. Aldo wondered how Datar knew about so many things outside our local space. He looked up to him as a big brother and trusted what he said. A crazy idea now hit Aldo in that moment. He took his pocket laser out and aimed it at the 3D logo sign on the craft. Maybe he was emboldened by what Datar said and or just bored enough. When Datar saw what he was doing, he immediately shouted, "No, don't!" But it was too late. Aldo had shot a beam at it. The little beam produced an unexpected effect. It instantly split and bounced off of the logo in several different directions. The instant reaction from the craft was a change in its flight path. It started to approach the trees where the boys were. They sat in the tree in disbelief for a few seconds, then climbed down as fast as they could. They started to run for the woods. The SS craft was now setting down in a clearing by the woods. Two robotic scout pods emerged from it and flew towards the woods. The two boys were running through the trees, not looking back. They knew they were coming to a fence soon, but before they reached the fence, they heard the buzz of the pods. A bright spotlight shone down on them. The tops of the trees bent out of the way by some invisible force. They could not escape these flying policeman things. A collector beam caught them, raising them up. The boys were held suspended and rose above the trees. Then the pods dutifully carried them over the trees to the clearing and set them down in front of the SSF ship. It was as big as a large two-story house. The two captured boys still could not move. It was as if they were being held by invisible ropes. Now as they waited what seemed like many minutes in front of this triangular and dark mystery ship with the two floating pods holding them on either side, they thought about Aldo's mistake. Then with the whirring sound, the door to the ship opened and a man walked out on a ramp that unfolded as he came down. By his uniform, they could tell he was an officer. He looked them over, chuckled, and said, "Release them." They could move now. "Did you boys know it was a serious offense to fire a laser at this vessel?" After a short silence, Aldo answered, "No, sir." "Let's have it." The SS officer held out his hand. Aldo felt his pocket and said, "I don't have it." The officer told one of the pods to go get it. It floated over to the trees, hovered for a few seconds, and then returned amazingly fast. It held the laser in a stasis and extended it to Aldo. Aldo took it and then promptly put it in the officer's hand. It was small with a very low range and could never have been any threat. The officer put it in his vest pocket. I don't care which of you shot it. You both are in trouble, but I am willing to let you off this time if you agree to do something. Datar looked away and said, Oh boy and man. This was his way of saying that this means trouble. Looking at Datar, the officer said, This is a rare opportunity for you. Just come inside here and let me show you around. You'll see what a grand future you could have as a member of the SSF. Datar and Aldo looked at each other. Aldo wanted to see the inside, but Datar did not. But since they were in trouble, Datar decided to stick with his friend. He said to the officer, Okay, we can take a look. Good. You boys will be the first in this community to get a tour. Right this way. They followed him up the ramp with the pods close behind. Aldo thought it was great that they were getting a personalized tour instead of going to jail. Datar did not say much with his distasteful expression. The ship was impressive with its fusion power and latest technology. The holographic displays were awesome and commanded rapt attention. They showed scenes of SSF fighting off invaders, building space posts, saving disaster victims, and even feeding children. They highlighted the skills you would learn and the fabulous places you would visit. After about 20 minutes of this, it had become obvious that it was designed to attract young people who longed for an escape to a hopefully better life. It all looked so good. It looked too good. Yes, Datar was right. They were there to recruit the young and less fortunate of the populace. The crew that they could see from a distance showed no interest in their presence and no emotion of any kind. Before they were allowed to leave, they were given holocubes with more information on how they could be the best of the galaxy. That was Aldo's first experience with the SSF and their interstellar craft. He had no interest in joining their organization because he took seriously Datar's warnings and also some experiences he had heard. But Aldo always had an interest in the truth. He was learning that the truth or the real reality was not always easy to see. He had a great interest in exploring space and the universe, known and unknown. So he continued climbing trees and looking up. Chapter 3, Apollo and Tiny. Stardate 6907.20. It was a pivotal year in this timeline of Earth's history. A delegation made up of the 28 known civilizations of the galaxy was to arrive at Tycho City on the moon on 20 July. This was the first time something like this had happened. Expectations were that an accord could be reached on interstellar cooperation and peace. Yet, some had doubts that it could ever be possible. So at best, it was a cautiously optimistic diplomatic affair with a never-fading touch of hope. The moon was more or less a neutral ground, since 60% of the moon's surface was inhabited by a dozen other so-called intelligent life forms. It was a cosmopolitan place, the other 40% of the surface being on the light side that could be seen from Earth was all Earth-owned real estate. The dark side and underneath, whatever was inside the moon, had always been off-limits to Earthlings. As long as each stayed on his side, there was a stable peace. Down on Earth, this was uppermost in people's minds. It was no different for Aldo. The different thing for Aldo this year, he being 14 now, was his attitude about himself. He was growing and no longer considered himself a child. He told people to call him Aldenon now. As was common to young people, he was finding it hard to concentrate on his studies in his learning cubicle. The images flashed by in rapid succession in the state's current force-feed style in this intermediate school. More of them were losing meaning to him, as only a few were really getting through. It was like wearing eye shields that filtered out all wavelengths of light but one. That one light for Aldenon was moonlight. How well could you see in moonlight? Not too well for Aldernon right now. He had an uneasy feeling about what was to happen up there. He wasn't quite sure why. But he liked some stories about when the moon was uninhabited, as far as we knew. Back then, in those stories, it was up there for people of the earth to look at, that's all. Just look and wonder at it and feel a sense of romance that was unique to people of earth. Now everything was so uncertain and even lacking clear purpose to him. Finally, the midday break came. You could emerge from your cube, go to the courtyard, and speak face to face with real people. Aldernon generally found a solitary spot to have his lunch. His friend Datar was in another school now. As he looked around, he noticed that not a lot of real talking was going on. Students were sitting together, but not looking and talking to each other. They were mostly preoccupied with their media packs. Almost everyone had them when they were not in class, or at least they could be activated only outside of classes. Most of them were small, 200mm cubed. They were multi-purpose. Inside them you could store your lunch, and of course any books for school. But they also could morph. Most of them, anyway, could transform into a small animal or pet, if you will. It was cool or fashionable to have a digipet. There was quite a variety of dogs, cats, birds, lizards, spider-looking things, but mostly dogs, albeit smaller than normal. A few students had larger ones. They gave an impression of an animal from a distance. A closer look revealed a computerized imitation with blinking lights and such. Those were the only kind of pets allowed in school. This degree of freedom was only found in the common area at break times. The students' every move was watched electronically. Anyone getting out of line was visited by security instantly. This prison-type environment was tolerable to most, since they only had to be there 3 to 5 hours a day. As Aldernon was reading in his older non-morphing media pack, he heard a clicking noise. It got louder until, boom, up jumped a digi-dog on his table and it started barking. This clearly startled Aldernon and evoked laughter from the two boys that sent the dog. The tinny-sounding artificial bark grated Aldernon's nerves more than the prank itself. "What's wrong, Aldo? Don't you like dogs?" from the sender. "My name is Aldernon, and yes, I do like dogs, but not this kind. I have a real dog." "You have a bio dog? You must live in the perimeter." "Near the edge of the city, where it is legal," Aldernon confirmed. "You were living in the past," came from one of the other boys. "Ku Klux, stop and come," Ponsam commanded the digi dog. It stopped barking, turned toward Ponsam, and jumped off the table. Then there was a whiz sound and it froze. Ponsam was a little surprised. He came over to it and picked it up by its head, saying, "He needs a power feed." "That would never happen with my dog Tangent." The other boys then bragged on their digi dogs and how they could climb vertical walls, take video and night vision, and recognize a million faces. Aldernon maintained his position that the bio dogs were the best. Some of them had never even seen a bio dog or any animal except in zoos because they were prohibited in the cities. Ponsam wanted to see a test between the two pets. Aldernon agreed. They set a time to meet in a park area near Aldernon's home. Ponsam overconfidently boasted, "Kuklik will bury your old bio bag of drool." He kept up the bad dog attitude in front of his friends. But Ponsam was curious about Aldernon's dog, and maybe a little jealous. Never before had the lunar world, Earth's moon, been the center of attention on this universal scale. Many were expecting history to be made, and a proverbial giant step taken forward for all known civilizations. The transgalactic beacons orbiting moon and Earth, TGBs as they were known, were beaming or nuding the latest reports to all planets within 100 light-years at far beyond light-speed. These satellite beacons were developed by a very ancient civilization and could relay messages across the galaxy. They had found a way to bypass physical laws of time and space. Only messages of the highest priority were sent by this means, and this event was the highest priority, at least for these 28 civilizations involved. Several SSF ships were orbiting the moon and were near the site of the Lunar Summit meeting. For their first 85 years of operation, they were known as the Space Security Force. Then, after their securing, or rather conquest, of several hundred light-year radius of Earth, the name was changed to Secured Space Force, and so they now operate in the secured space. They definitely made their presence known, even though more than a few governors had objected to SSF for years. The powers that be at that time felt SSF was necessary. The various spacecrafts were down in the large flat landing area outside of Tycho City. Special capsules held each delegate and transported them to the meeting place. These capsules provided the needed atmospheres, each in correct balance for each delegate. They remained in these capsules for the duration of the proceedings. Translating and visuals were done automatically. So began the first truly galactic-level meeting of intelligent life forms. Vegans, Orions, and Centaurans, as they were known to Earth people, were concerned with trade, science, and the zones of influence. And the so-called M31 Sethis, Danusians, Princes of Rigel IX, and Psi-Dekpok were more interested in cultural exchange and histories of life entities. As all this was going on, Den Rollinger, the security chief for this summit, was watching everything intently. To him, this event was an invitation for someone to cause an incident, a big one. While the members of his team were watching all the surrounding area, Roland, for short, was examining the capsules containing the delegates. The inside of the capsules could not be seen except partially through the view screens. He was particularly interested in one, the one from Deneb Colony 5. According to his intel reports, the new High Chamberlain was here with his party of three consuls. This new Chamberlain did not have a history to speak of before 10 star years. The report just mentioned his school and home port. Watching the view screens closely, Roland could see the three party members of his delegation from Deneb C5 in the background. Sometimes one or two of them would pass out of view. Their seats in the capsule were behind the Chamberlain's and easily seen on the view screen. About 6 hours into the summit, during the conversations with Cassiopeia delegation, Roland noticed something unusual. One of the party of Deneb had been out of view for about a half an hour. Roland decided to investigate. The nearly full moon was bigger, brighter, and more than the night light it always was. Because of what was going on there, Earth dwellers saw it in a new light. It was perhaps a light that shone into a brighter future. For countless generations, Earthlings, watching the moon, was the natural light of night. The sun was the day. Both were essential to life on Earth. It had become well known and accepted that the moon was the perfect counterweight for Earth in this great clockwork solar system. Without it, Earth would lose its tilted axis and would wobble unsteadily, causing extremes in temperatures that would be devastating to all life. So the moon has watched Earth as a faithful witness in the sky for all recorded time. In more recent times, Earth and Moon have witnessed each other in a new way. Aldenon thought of it as in a game he played once at a friend's house. Enemy Mine was a detective-type game, best played in a group of 7 or more. One of the group was an enemy or killer. The investigator, who sat in the middle of the room, had to determine by a series of tests or questions who the enemy was. After an interview of a player by the investigator or questioner, the players would write on their numbered cards a single mark. Then the cards were mixed and handed out to each one. Players must remember their numbers. Only the enemy had a red marker. The red mark on a card meant that the player with that number was out. For example, if card number 4 has a red mark, player number 4 is eliminated by the enemy. The player who receives the number 4 card when they are dealt, may choose to announce that player number 4 is out, or he may not. If player number 4 gets his number 4 card with the red mark, he must say so and go out. It was the idea that an old friend could now be an enemy is what Aldenon applied to the situation on the moon. It could hold a deadly secret. The other game he thought about was friend or foe. That one was similar in that one person was in the center of a circle of people who were passing a ball around. Each time one tossed it, he would say friend. Anyone at any time might say foe and throw it hard at the one in the center. These things occupied Aldenon's mind as he waited for Ponsam to come. He still found it hard to make sense of the world at that time. Finally, Ponsam arrived with one of his friends from school. As they walked up the path toward Aldenon, Ponsam commented, "Wow, Aldo, this is farther out in the perimeter park than I thought. It's like a real nature trail setting." "Yeah, I like it," Aldenon responded, then said, "Glad you could come. Who is your friend?" "This is Wooster. He wanted to see how a drooler loses to a digidog." "Let's start the dog show. I don't have all night," the friend said as he looked back at his media pod. "Tangent is always ready for some fun and tricks," Aldenon assured positively. The first things were Aldenon's that Tangent was good at. He had him stand on his hind legs. The digidog, Kuklik, did that equally well. Then there were the rollover, play dead, speak, heel, sit, and jumping tricks. Aldenon was surprised that Kuklik could do all those. The best thing Ponsam could say about Tangent was cute. The flying disc was interesting to see. Tangent chased it, then jumped up and caught it as it was curving back toward them. You could tell he enjoyed doing that. Kuklik attacked the disc at lightning speed, knocking it to the ground and then biting it so hard that he put holes in it. Ponsam started to make brags that his digidog could follow a bird with a laser beam and then climb a tree after it. "Your drooler cannot analyze 157 different radio frequencies, can it?" he taunted. "No, Ponsam, but he has a good nose and he can follow a scent. Let me show you." Aldenon took a ball from his pocket, rubbed it with his hands, and let Tangent sniff it. Then he gave it to Ponsam. "Can Kuklik do this?" "Of course he can," Ponsam replied. He put it to the digidog's nose and then threw it way into the trees. They both told their dogs to fetch. Away they ran into the wooded area. After a few seconds, there was a beeping sound from Ponsam's friend Wooster. He said someone was calling and he had to leave now. Ponsam immediately called the digidog back. He was actually relieved because he felt sure Tangent would come up with the ball first and win this test. Ponsam's dog obediently trotted back, the hum being audible as he got closer. Pushing a button on it, there was a hiss and it folded up into a cube. "We will finish this later, Aldo," Ponsam said as he and his friend quickly walked away. Less than a minute later, out came Tangent with the ball, wagging his tail happily. Roland could see some kind of marks in the fine dust near the Deneb capsule. They were not like tracks, just random marks as if someone took a rock and tried to roll it over the surface. He wasn't sure if it meant anything, but he followed it on foot in his EVA suit. Roland now alerted his team. "Maintain posts. Pursuing possible tracks from Capsule 17, maybe leaving the area temporarily." He used his thruster pack once, covering a distance of about 10 meters. The ground began to slope upward as he approached the edge of Tycho Crater. Using the thruster pack again, he floated up the side to the rim of the crater. From there, he could see the rises of Oro Crater in the distance. Just then, his eye caught some movement near a large rock at the base of the rim. The thrust pack helped him get down the rim, which was quite steep. He was focused on the spot where the movement was. Now being on the outside of Tycho Crater and not sure what else to look for, Roland suspected the answer may be hidden beneath the surface. He was in an uninhabited area where there was hundreds of degrees of temperature between light and shadow, mysterious disappearing tracks, treacherous terrain, and something had moved nearby. He walked up to the large rock very cautiously. It was as large as a small house. He slowly walked around it. Seeing nothing unusual, he said to himself, "I guess this was a wasted moonwalk." He pushed his comm button and said, "I'm on the north rim. Did not find any..." He stopped because static suddenly overwhelmed his hearing. The comm was being blocked. Roland now had a sinking feeling, not just inside, but literally under his feet. He turned around to see a hole opening up in the surface. Another rock was rising up from it. It was narrow and rose to the height of Roland's head. He tried to run from it. He could only back against the large rock because something prevented him from moving left or right. As he stood there stunned, the new rock began to change. With little flashes of light, it was changing its shape and whole appearance. Roland should not have been able to hear anything, yet there was a crackling sound like branches in a campfire. In a few seconds, the rock had assumed the shape of a man, looking like Roland himself, except with no face, just a black visor. The twin of him stepped toward him until it was close enough to touch him. Then, reaching out, the twin did just that and pressed against Roland's chest. At that, the rock face opened, and they both entered into blackness. This was the end for Roland, apparently, being swallowed by a rock on the moon. No one at the Tycho City summit knew what had happened to him. Only one member of his team knew he went to the edge of the crater, but that is all. Just before the rock face became solid again, there was a bright flash in the transformation, and something shot out of the rock, out into space and toward the Earth. Less than an hour later, Aldenon was in his room at home reading when he got a call. It was Ponsum. He invited Aldenon to come out to Overshadow Lake. Ponsum said he was alone and that he wanted to talk to him about something important. Aldenon was curious and agreed. He came to the spot Ponsum described, which was a lonely and rocky area, and Tangent was with him. "How do you like this for outland?" was Ponsum's greeting as he came out from behind a rock. "It's great. I like it out here. What's up, Ponsum?" Ponsum motioned for Aldenon to come his way. He then led him to a flat rock that was a good one to sit on. "My uncle took me out here a few years ago. It is a perfect place to sit and look out over the lake. We had a super time that day, and I've missed him. Not many people come over here because of the rocks, so that makes it a good place to talk about important things, right?" hinted Aldenon. "Yeah, Aldenon. Before I get to the reason I chose this spot, I want to say I'm sorry for those times I made fun of you at school." "Well, Aldenon started to say. "Please hear me out first. I wanted to look good in front of my friends. You know, always in control and cutting edge and like that. Then this morning when I saw how you and your dog were together..." He glanced at Tangent, who was watching the lake. "That really impressed me." Aldenon smiled. "And you don't seem to be bothered by not having a digi-dog like the rest of the students. You have a kind of peace and calm. Does the bio-dog give that to you?" Aldenon, a little surprised, paused, then said, "Yeah, I guess he does. Tangent and me are close. He is probably my closest friend these days." "Listen, Aldenon, I know this may be hard to do, but do you think I could get a bio-dog too?" "Well, it mainly depends on where you reside. I live in the city, and as long as I'm there, I'll never get a bio dog or bio anything." "You can always go to Bioland," Aldenon offered. "True, but it is not like having your own bio friend like you do, Aldenon. You have a treasure." "Now I know that is true, Ponsum. Anyway, I called you here to discuss something else. I know you are intensely interested in what is going on the moon. Well, I have a connection to that summit up there." "How is that?" was the intense reply. "I don't tell many people this, but my uncle Den is a security chief in the SSF. He has been assigned to that event. When he was here at the lake, he told me about the EB-2. It is an emergency alert system secretly developed with an alien technology. It can send an orb with a request for help at light speed or even faster. About an hour ago, my Mii Cube received a tachyon pulse from him. That means that he is in trouble. He threw a stone to the water and continued. It is sort of like back in ancient times when a ship in trouble sent up a flare. Do you know what I mean? Yes, I learned that in history. So what can we do about it? Well, that depends on the orb, when it gets here, and what we can get from it. You see, the fact that the trouble signal came to me shows that it may have been damaged. It was designed to go to the nearest help, which would be on the moon. But he told me that if it gets damaged somehow, that it would go to its default mode, deeply embedded in it. He chose to send it to me in that case. I guess he trusts me and knows that I respect him a lot. He paused, looking over the lake. Wow, Ponsum, your uncle is a Rizmon, a slang term meaning a hero. I hope he's all right. When do you think we will see that orb? That I don't know for sure. Since it was damaged, it will not be traveling at light speed. It could take hours. It is supposed to come down near this spot if it functions properly. So we have to keep a good watch. It has already been 1 hour. My Mii Cube says it is on the way, so that is a good sign. So they continued to sit watching and listening over Overshadow Lake. They were quiet, but their thoughts went out over the water like a whistling spinner skipping across the surface as far as possible. Their thoughts were of the events of the last 2 days on Earth and the Moon. They wondered how this might change their lives and even the course of history. Aldenon was glad that he did not write off Ponsum as a friend even after that ridicule from him. Ponsum was glad that Aldenon gave him another chance and was tolerant of him. He did not bring his digi-dog because he knew that Aldenon would have his dog Tangent with him, and he knew that if they needed the dog to find the orb, the dog would be up to the task. For another hour, the two boys and a dog kept watch at the edge of the lake. They skipped any flat rocks they found out over the surface. Aldenon then tried something with Tangent that he had not done for some time. He skipped a small light rock a short distance and told Tangent to go after it. The dog eagerly jumped in and swam before the rock went down. When he got to where it went down, the dog went under the water. After only a few seconds, he was up and let out a yelp as if to say, "I'm sorry, I missed it. Can I try it again?" Aldenon knew just what Tangent wanted, so he skipped another one out about 4 meters from the edge. This time the dog came up with the rock in his mouth, bringing it quickly to Aldenon. He was wagging his tail vigorously and was clearly excited. "What a super dog! What will he do next, fly?" exclaimed Ponsum. "When I stayed with my grandparents in Corbinfet Township, there was not much to do except swim in their private lake. Tangent took to the water like a fish." "That's fantastic. We may need him to fetch the orb if it lands in the lake. It is supposed to come to the surface," Uncle said, "but it may not." They continued a while longer, enjoying the afternoon in anticipation of the moon orb. Gray clouds were encroaching as breezes started to come in upon them. Ponsum told Aldenon he could go home if he wanted. Aldenon confirmed to him that he would stay and wait it out. A local security pod flew by for the second time. Finally, they both heard a hissing noise. Looking skyward, a faint light could be seen past the clouds. Emerging from the clouds, it became very bright and was streaking down. Ponsum's Mii Cube started beeping loudly. The meteor-like streak landed in the lake about a stone's throw to their left. They immediately ran to the nearest spot on the shore. It had hit maybe 8 meters out. They waited to see if it would bob up to the surface. After a few minutes, nothing happened. "Aldenon, do you think Tangent can fetch it for us?" "I think so. Is it small enough and cool enough?" "It is small enough to fit in the palm of your hand, and it should be cool enough now." Aldenon commanded his dog to fetch it. Tangent, as if knowing exactly what to look for, swam to the spot and went under. He came up after a few seconds with nothing. "Find it, boy, find it," encouraged Aldenon. The dog went down again. This time he was under the water about 3 times longer. Aldenon waded out into the lake, calling Tangent. Ponsum said in a low, serious tone, "The depth there is only about 1.5 meters. But maybe this was a bad idea." Suddenly he popped up and came right to Aldenon, who grabbed him up from the water. At that moment, Tangent's closed mouth opened, and out shot the orb. It seemed to bounce over the water to the rocky ground. Amazing! How does he do that? Is he all right? Yes, he is fine, but I was getting a little scared. They both looked down at the orb, which was still glowing slightly. I don't think we could have got it without your dog. Thank you, friend. He carefully picked up the orb, saying, After landing, it solidifies. Let's get out of here before the security pod comes around again. Uncle Den told me not to let anyone else get their hands on this thing. Aldenon followed Ponsum to his home near the intermediate school. When the orb ball was put into a chamber on Ponsum's me-cube, the cube began to vibrate, hiss, fade in and out of sight. Then the information started coming out. It projected a holographic image of Roland walking on the moon. It showed the exact time and location. They saw the other mirror image person, and then when they passed out of sight into that rock. Because it had been damaged, it was somewhat fuzzy. Then there was a broken message that said, Possible contact with co laser mess. That was all. What does it mean, Ponsum? I think he may have been taken hostage. It says possible contact with co-CO, maybe an enemy. And this part, laser mess, MES, I really don't know. I do know that the SSF sometimes use a special frequency laser to transmit classified information for relatively short distances. This me cube that my uncle gave me does have a laser port. Within the hour, they found themselves on the flat part of Ponsum's roof. Setting the cube firmly on a table so it would not move, Ponsum faced it toward the rising full moon. Then they waited and reflected on this unusual day. As the moon reached a point about 27 degrees from the horizon, it had now been 4.5 hours since the orb was launched from the moon. A hum started up from the cube. Then a red beam shot out of the cube, straight for the moon. They were amazed at the little cube's intense power. It lasted for about 30 seconds, changing colors during transmission. After being alerted by the beam, security team members found Roland next to that rock. His oxygen was nearly gone, but he was alive. The summit talks continued without disturbance. During a break, Roland was questioned after his physical exam. He did not remember what happened after entering the rock, but with his description of certain tracks, the rock, and the broken speculative message of the orb, the evidence suggested that Callisti Moon were at work. This was a life form which had existed under and perhaps on the surface of the moon for ages. They were chameleons, able to disappear into their surroundings, making them very hard to detect. There was never any confirmed interaction with human-like species, but there were myths associated with them. The mysterious fourth person in the Deneb capsule and the look-alike of Roland on the surface were very unusual. It was speculated that they had a curiosity as to the summit event. In any event, Roland was very grateful for the help of Ponsum, Aldenon, and Tangent for his rescue. They remained close friends.